My daughter called me today, screaming and crying for her life. She lives in LA, downtown LA. Goes to college there. On her way to Starbucks, which is less than 2 minutes from her apartment, a man got on a electric scooter and then proceeded to point a gun to her head. She started screaming and she started running. He started following her. She ran into an alley and she lost her shoes. And then she ran into I can't recall if it's not Food for Less, but it's a grocery store that's in downtown LA. And she ran in with no shoes, screaming and crying, begging for help that there was a man trying to kill her. They asked her if she wanted to call the police, and she was just frazzled. She's just 21. She just frazzled and she just said, you know, please, will you walk me home, get me home. She was supposed to come back home to where we live today for the holidays. And the store manager said that he would walk her because she lived right next door to the grocery store. And about that time, a Hispanic woman, woman pulled up in the front and jumped out of the car. And she said, honey, are you okay? Okay, I saw everything, and started hugging her. And my daughter broke down and she cried. And this lady, you know, she said, mom, I knew she was a mom, that she was safe enough, and that the mom said, here, I'll take you home. And so she got in the car with her and she came home. As soon as she got home, she called me screaming and crying at the top of her lungs. And honestly, I thought she was pulling a prank. I had not ever seen her this unbelievably hysterical. And when she started telling me that someone had put a gun to her head, it was like my worst nightmare come true. Okay, I'm gonna breathe for a moment, and there's gonna be a part two. Okay, so I had another video that I had started after my first part one, and honestly, I was so out of sorts that I decided to take a deep breath and regroup and clarify. Okay, so to begin with, my daughter did call the police. Yes, were there some, you know, maybe missteps or things she could have done better? Absolutely. But I really defy anyone that is in the middle of something this catastrophic to have a clear head. It's not always easy, especially when you're 21 and not 53 like me, or, you know, with much life experience. That being said, she should have called the police right away, but she didn't. She made it home safely. In hindsight, some people have said she should have never gotten in the car with the woman, and she probably shouldn't have, for sure. You know, you don't think about these things until hindsight's 20/20, right? Something else I want to clarify, because this has really, really bothered my daughter. First of all, my daughter, honestly, she didn't want me to post this. In fact, I had to kind of give it a little time and then explain to her why I felt it was imperative that we share this. The things that really bothered her, and, you know, I take it all with a grain of salt with what people say, because they get little bits of a story. I understand that I was kind of all over the place in my storytelling, but it was fresh and it was raw. And that is, yes, this happened. This wasn't some made up story. It actually happened. Some people have said, well, why would she run into an alley? Well, it was next to grocery outlet, and there are lots of alleys and all that. When you are you know, running and in threat of your life, you don't necessarily think clearly about where to run. You just want safety. You just want safety. So I just want to get that out into the thing. She is telling the truth. She is embarrassed that I've said anything. She just wants it to go away. But she's afraid, and it's really, really crappy that she has to live in this fear every day. She loves her school. It's a small art school. It's not UCLA. It's a small art school downtown. She loves her school. She's got a year and a half left. You know, I worry, you know, that she can be kept safe for a year and a half. That is a long time, because I've explained to her that she got away lucky, so unbelievably lucky this time, and next time it may not be so. Many people have said she shouldn't live there, she can commute. Well, there's a couple issues with that. First of all, even if you commute, she still has to get, even if she commutes and lives someplace that we can like put her away in a quiet little safe place, she still has to commute into downtown LA to go to school. So yes, I think it would mitigate some of the danger for sure, but the fact that she still has to go through this war zone is not okay. I called the school on Monday and I spoke to kind of one of the head people at the college, and obviously he was horrified, but he said they have great security on campus, but that there's nothing that they can do outside of the campus. He said what he has told all the students is never leave your apartment, your dorm ever alone, that you are never safe. So that basically, if she is to go out of her apartment, that she must have someone with her at all times. The fact that my daughter has to, you know, even the school is saying you must always travel in pairs, even at 9 a.m. on a Sunday to go to Starbucks less than two minutes from your house, is not okay. I tell you that about a year ago, one of her classmates' mom and her were walking outside of a 7-Eleven when a homeless man came and stabbed the classmate in the stomach. She obviously immediately left and they moved out of state. Thank God she survived, but I don't recall all the details of what happened. I was horrified then, and I didn't want her to be at the school. But as a mom, you want to protect, but you also want to give them some choice. You know, there comes a point where they have to make some decisions for themselves, even though I'm the one that's paying for school, paying for the apartment and all of that. I'm trying my best to respect her, but try to figure out how we can, you know, keep her safe. But here, this is why this needs to be shared. I mentioned to you that my daughter, that she did not want me to say anything because she just wanted to kind of go away, and she was embarrassed and didn't want me to make a big deal about it. But we have to make a big deal about these things. We have got, as a society, we have got to stop allowing the darkness in the world. We have got to stop allowing the dark forces of the world to keep us small, afraid, and scared. It is going to take concerned citizens, citizen journalism. That is our only hope. Because it is clear to me that our city officials, the county and the state, especially in California, I'm sure it's, you know, similar in other big cities, nothing is being done. Nothing. When the LA police tell you don't come down to downtown LA because we can't protect you, what does that say? It is up to us. We have to start shedding the light on the darkness and stop being afraid. Because if we don't, what we see now is only the beginning. My heart breaks. It breaks for all of the hardworking people that are in all of these cities that are being destroyed, and that they live in fear for their life every day. One thing that's been very apparent is obviously with me sharing the story with my daughter, is that, you know, the thousands and thousands of comments that have just come in the last 24 hours is how many people have had their own similar stories, some far worse, that have happened. So this isn't new. This isn't a novelty. This is real, and it's happening. And I know, like I said, it's not happening just LA. It's happening everywhere. And please help me. Help me shed the light on these areas, that if we can just, every time we see something that's nefarious and terrible, share it. Now, I'm not one to, in fact, I hate sharing bad news, but I think in this situation, I am normally not the person you will ever hear say, let's talk about the dark stuff. Let's talk about, let's share the negative stuff, because I don't believe in, you know, in giving a platform and adding fuel to the fire. I'm that girl who, you know, let's be the light. Let's be more uplifting and share and, you know, and be the example of what is good. But in this case, unfortunately, I believe that we have to start sharing all of those situations, those incidences, the more that we can give fuel to that, at least as an awareness, not to make it okay, but to say it's not okay. That's our only hope. That's our only hope. Yeah, my head's spinning. I have a headache. My stomach hurts. My daughter just wants to enjoy her Christmas, and I want to enjoy Christmas too. I want us all to feel safe, to feel loved, to celebrate the season. Sorry for the long pause. Sometimes, my stomach hurts. Sometimes it's necessary. This is real. This is real life, guys. Wishing you all a beautiful, beautiful Christmas and a Happy New Year. And all of you who have listened to my story, to my daughter's story, I so appreciate the 99% of you that have, you know, have been really supportive and kind and gracious and understanding. And please, I say, share the awareness together, you know, a small group of people can do amazing things. There's some, I can't remember the exact quote, but it's like, never underestimate the power of a small group of like-minded people to do great things. So my daughter and I have a lot of talking to do over the next couple, you know, actually the next week or so, to really make a decision on what she's going to do. But anyway, thank you all for being a safe place for me to land and to share this. I'll do the same for you. Merry Christmas.